Hi, everybody, and welcome to the show. This is the ION Media Networks, and we are welcoming you, and we're going to be talking today about the hidden cost of moving goods across the United States, taxing the environment. Mina, okay, let me see if I get this name right. This is a pretty name. Mina Paliniapin.
Yes.
Did I get it right?
Yeah.
All right. That is a great last name and a very
Thank
pretty
you.
First name.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. Mina is a senior research associate at the Pacific Institute, which is a think tank located in the Oakland, California area, right?
Yes, that's right.
Excellent.
Pacific Institute has been around for 20 years. We're actually hitting our 20-year anniversary next year. And we are a think tank that really works on the issues at the intersection of environment, development, and security, recognizing that those things are very interconnected in our global world. And we have three major programs. One is on water and sustainability, looking at the lack of fresh water, waterborne disease rates in developing countries, figuring out solutions for those things. Our other program is on economic globalization and the environment. We have a more global world, we have the World Trade Organization, the International Standards Organization. How is that affecting people's lives on the ground? And our third program, the program that I direct, is called Community Strategies for Sustainability and Justice. And it's a program that really looks at how are communities being impacted by environmental pollution. Mm-hmm. And what we found through our years of research, we've been around for about 7 years at the Institute, is that there are certain communities, low-income communities, communities of color, Latino communities, black communities, that are more impacted by environmental pollution than other communities. They're sort of the fourth world living within the first world.
Wow.
And we have an industrial society which is giving us a lot of benefits, and some people are bearing the burden of it.
Yeah. Man, what a hotbed of activities for you guys to be working with, especially in light of what's been going on recently. Although I guess, you know, environmentally speaking, these things have been going on for a while, but we're now just starting to see what the results are. And we talk about things such as global warming and all, and it's amazing. I mean, all of a sudden, some big issues and decisions that we're going to be having to make very, very soon.
Absolutely. Global warming is an issue that the Pacific Institute works a lot on, mm-hmm. especially around the water issue, from sort of an environmental justice perspective, which is sort of the lens that our program works in.
Mm-hmm.
Climate change has really significant impacts on poor communities throughout the world. So island nations, low-lying nations like Bangladesh, who aren't putting out as much of the carbon dioxide pollution, are going to be the first that are going to suffer its impacts. So
mm-hmm.
that's
yeah.
a big issue.
Unbelievable. A little background on you. How did you become so involved with the environment? Did you know early on when you were a little girl that you had a fascination with the environment and interactions and things like that?
It was in high school when I sort of heard in the summer camp sort of this life-changing speech where it was just the world is going to hell in a handbasket, it just really sort of energized me. It was sort of the cause that I wanted to work on, and so went back to high school, started recycling club and environmental club, and went to college to pursue an environmental engineering degree because I really felt like I wanted to be the one that was developing the solutions to these problems and not sort of criticizing the way
mm-hmm.
things were going. And after college, I went to India, where it was really clear to me that environmental problems were public health problems, that people were dying because of a poor quality environment, because
mm-hmm.
of pollution in the water, because of pollution in the air. And so that really caused me to want to focus on issues in those communities where environmental problems were public health problems.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Interesting, and it's funny how sometimes we'll hear something like that. Something will happen to us in our lives, and it'll just totally change the direction in which we go. But what a great direction, because I'm sure a lot of people are going to benefit from your research and your commitment to finding out what the truth is. And thank goodness for organizations like yours, because we know that certainly at times communication doesn't get out there for various reasons due to. Yeah, certain organizations or ways that we are operating. So, the interesting thing is, you call it the intersection,
mm-hmm.
the intersection of the way we live with the environment, and all. And that intersection seems to be more blocked than open nowadays. Are we not coming to the head in many issues? And that includes the issue in which we're going to discuss today. But overall, I mean, it seems like we're really coming to the point of where we're facing major decisions.
Yeah, I think that we're starting to see the ways in which our impacts on the environment are having a global impact, a local impact. Our studies on global warming have already shown sort of the increase in storm weather events. We're starting to see an increase in that. So I think we are coming to a head. A lot of choices need to be made, and there are choices, mm-hmm. and we have great options. We just need to make the right choices.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's go ahead and get into the nitty-gritty now and the work that you've been studying here. And, you know, the term goods movements or goods movement is kind of a broad term, mm-hmm. but it's really what it means. And yeah. that is the transportation, the moving of goods from one point to another, right?
Yeah, mm-hmm. absolutely. I think another way to think about it is freight movement, sort of when you see those box cars, all the places where you see those box cars. From where they get off on marine vessels, off of ships, at ports, to getting put on trains, to getting put on trucks, and eventually being emptied out at their retail destination, like a Walmart or a Home Depot or an IKEA. So goods movement or freight movement is the whole system of moving for sale or raw materials from their point of origin to their final point of sale. So it's an entire industry around mm-hmm. that. And it includes importers like IKEA, like Walmart, mm-hmm. Like Home Depot. It includes exporters, so companies in the U.S. that are exporting out to other countries. It includes shipping companies, a lot of whom are multinational Chinese-based shipping companies. And it includes rail companies and the trucking industry. So those are kind of the major players in the system of goods movement.
Yeah, I spend a lot of time in the Midwest, and it's really interesting. You're striking a chord with me all of a sudden, a very visual one. Yeah, we've always had trains, but they were never these multi-leveled carriers that, like you said, that are coming off the ships and all. Now the landscape of the Midwest, which is very flat, you can look out miles away, you'll see this train. You know, that's higher decked and all, and it's funny because I mean, actually, the landscape has changed with this.
That's absolutely right. What goods movement is doing is changing the landscape of communities throughout the United States, and it's goods movement is expanding rapidly. Mm-hmm. It basically we can't even imagine how much things are going to be changing. Mm-hmm. The state of California estimates that the movement of goods through California alone is going to double or triple in the next 15 years. So that is a huge, huge impact. We're talking about in the Port of LA Long Beach right now, which is the number one largest port complex in the country. There are about 44,000 trucks that come in and out of that port complex every single day in order to upload and download containers.
44,000 a day?
So we're talking about a tripling of that. And in the Port of Oakland, which is in the Bay Area where I work, it's not as large a port as the Port of LA Long Beach, but it's the fourth largest marine port in the country, so it's quite significant. And the community that is the neighbor to the Port of Oakland, called West Oakland, mm-hmm. Right now faces about 15,000 truck trips per day.
Wow.
And so to imagine a tripling of that is just phenomenal. And so I guess one of the things that I'd like to do, and you sort of have had that experience living in the Midwest, is just to sort of imagine what it's like to live under the cranes or next to a rail yard or next to a distribution center and the kinds of impacts that has, being kept up by truck idling at night, going outside your front door to take your child to school and having a huge big rig lumber down your neighborhood street causing safety concerns for you.